الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه استغفره واستهديه واعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله ارسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعه من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد ومن يعص الله ورسوله فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء اتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما وبعد احبتي في الله ما زال الناس يتحدثون عما جعلوه او عما جعلوا الامس مناسبه لها ما زال الناس يتحدثون عن الحب واهميته حتى جعلوا له يوما واحدا من العام يحتفلون فيه به وسنبين في آخر هذه الخطبة إن شاء الله حكم اعتبار أو اتخاذ مثل هذه المناسبات عيدا في دين الإسلام إلا أن المناسبة تثير جدلا أو يكثر الاهتمام بها أو بسببها عن مبدأ وهذا المبدأ هو من الحاجات النفسية التي فطر الله عز وجل عباده عليها إلا أنك إذا أردت أن تعرف همة الشخص ومكانته فليس عليك إلا أن تنظر في مجال اهتماماته وفيما تعلق قلبه به فإن تعلق قلبه بالمال كانت همته في حدود ما يمكنه هذا المال من أن يصله وإن تعلقت همته أو تعلق قلبه بالعلم كانت همته ومكانته بقدر ما يوصله هذا العلم إليه وإن تعلقت مشاعره وأحاسيسه بالجنس الآخر كانت همته ومكانته التي يصل إليها بقدر ما تعلق قلبه به وإذا أردت أن تعرف أو أن تحدد ما تعلق قلب الإنسان به فليس لك إلا أن تنظر في حاله وفيما يرجوه من دنياه وفي اهتماماته وأكبر ما يدلك على اهتمام المرء ما يدعو الله عز وجل به عندنا مثال ذكره الله عز وجل وزكاه لنا وأمرنا باتباعه لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر فماذا كان اهتمام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبما تعلق قلبه عليه الصلاة والسلام انظر إلى دعائه صلى الله عليه وسلم لأن المرء إنما يدعو الله عز وجل ويطلب منه ما تعلق قلبه به. فبماذا تعلق قلب نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في آخر حديث طويل، قال سل، يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى قال لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سل، اطلب اطلب تمنى، اسأل الله عز وجل حاجتك ماذا تريد. فما كان لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا أن دعا بهذا الدعاء، اللهم إني أسألك فعل الخيرات. الله أكبر، اللهم إني أسألك فعل الخيرات، مش أسألك الخيرات أنا عايز، لا، أسألك فعل الخيرات وترك المنكرات مما حرمه الله عز وجل وحب المساكين، وأن تغفر لي وترحمني، وإذا أردت بقوم فتنة فتوفني إليك غير مفتون. ثم قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأسألك حبك وحب من يحبك وحب كل عمل يقربني إلى حبك. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إنها حق فادرسوها ثم تعلموها. اللهم إني أسألك إيش؟ وأسألك حبك وحب من يحبك وحب كل عمل يقربني إلى حبك. بهذا تعلق قلب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، تعلق قلبه بالله عز وجل، تعلق قلبه بخالقه، تعلق قلبه برازقه، فكانت همته عليه الصلاة والسلام على قدر ما تعلق قلبه به. وبما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تعلق قلبه بأسمى حب، كانت همته هي أسمى همة عرفها التاريخ، وكان قدره عليه الصلاة والسلام لأنه صدق في هذا التعلق، كان قدره عليه الصلاة والسلام أرفع قدر. فما كان لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، انظر تأثير هذه المحبة وهذا التعلق في حياة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، انظر إلى أثر هذه المحبة في حياته، لأن الإنسان يجد بما تعلق قلبه به أثرا في حياته. من كانت همته في السيارات تعلق قلبه بالسيارة، أصبح عنده إيش؟ هوس بموضوع السيارات، وأصبحت حياته كلها مسفرة في متابعة آخر الموديلات وما شابه. وكذلك الحال فيما تعلق قلبه بأي شيء آخر، صرف حياته وجهده في سبيل ما تعلق قلبه به. My dear brothers and sisters, these are the days where people talk about love and passion, obviously. In fact, a day was dedicated for love. And many people were amongst those who celebrated yesterday as a day dedicated for this issue. As to the ruling, the Islamic ruling on celebrating or observing a day like Valentine's Day, that will inshallah be clarified at the end of the khutbah. But the occasion reminds us of the issue of love. And as they say, if you want to, and by the way, let me get this piece of information out of the way. Valentine's Day is also the day where most breakups take place. Most people and most relationships, or the highest number of breakups in relationships takes place on that day. I guess people come to the realization of how trivial or how shallow those relationships are, and on that day they cannot make any more commitments, so they decide to end it on that day. But putting this aside, if you want to know someone's significance in life, then you have to examine or look closely at what his concern is all about. So one's passion, concern, or love determines his or her status or significance in life. Because what we love determines how we view life. What we love, your love determines how you live your life. You live by what you love. Whatever passion you have, that's what becomes the driving force in your life. So people who are into wealth, for example, that is a driving force in their life, and their passion becomes that wealth, and everything that they do in life will be for that purpose. And likewise, people who have passion for knowledge, or people who have passion for anything else. For instance, people who have passion for cars, they become obsessed with them. They know everything about them. People who are obsessed or have passion for sports, they become obsessed with the sports, they know everything about sports. Now, as Muslims, my dear brothers and sisters, dear believers, as Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us an example. And He ordered us to follow that example. And it was indeed the best of examples. And we all love or claim to love that example. We are all actually longing and looking forward to the day where we are going to be reunited, or where we are going to be in the company of that example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us. Each and every single one of us claims that he loves that example. Each and every single one of us dreams of the day he's going to be united with that example. And that is none other than our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what was the passion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What earned him this high status, in fact the highest status that any human being can reach? What makes millions of people love him, and what makes billions of people respect him, is the way he lived his life. And we said that the person lives his life according to whatever passion he has. So what was the passion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They say that in order for you to know what someone is passionate about, you need to look into what they pray for, what they ask for. What is it that they pray for? What is it that they ask for? What is their request in life? A quick glance at one of the supplications and prayers of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam answers this question. The Prophet, peace be upon him, it was reported that he basically was told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to ask O Muhammad, pray, ask of me. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a long hadith, prayed. What was the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Let's just take, for the sake of time, take the last portion of that prayer. He says in his prayer, he said, O Allah, I ask for your love. And the love of those who love you, or those who have your love. And the love of any deed or any action that will make me closer to your love. This was the passion of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yesterday, brothers and sisters, I was having a conversation with a brother when he said something very profound. I found it to be very interesting. He said, love. And we weren't actually, subhanAllah, talking about even this issue. We were talking about time management, how one can organize his life and all of that. So he said, love actually helps organize or bring order to your life. And I said, how come? He said, look for example at a single person or someone who falls in love with something or someone. All of a sudden, their life, their activities, everything that starts revolving around that love and that passion of theirs. People get married, they have a chaotic lifestyle, they get married, all of a sudden they become organized. Everything works around that love of theirs. So I said, yeah, that's quite an observation. So he said, in order to bring some kind of order or organization in anyone's life, they have to have some kind of love, something that they have, they are in love with. But that love has to be solid. And that's what many people who think they have love in their lives, or who are looking for love, that's what many people miss. A solid, authentic love. That's what caused a psychiatrist to write an article. And in the article she said that love is of four levels. And most people don't realize this. She said the first level is the love of something for what it offers you, what it grants you, what it gives you, what you get out of it. And then she gives an example. You know, you might love a child, for example, right? For that pleasure or that you get from looking at them. They're very cute, they're very nice. Or you might like some kind of food for its taste, for whatever you get out of it. And she said, this kind of love is a very shallow love, very trivial, very selfish. The second level of love is to love something or to love someone for what they love about you, for what they like about you. So for instance, someone thinks that you're funny, or someone thinks that you are good, or someone thinks that you are ethical, or someone thinks that you're cute, or someone thinks whatever they think of you. And because they have good feelings about you or for you, then you start exchanging those kind of feelings with them. So this is a mutual type of love. However, she says, it's not much better than the previous one, the first one, because it is also a selfish, a shallow love. For in reality, the person is in love with nothing other than themselves, because you love what the other person loves about you. That takes us to the third level of love, which is the love of what you offer, not what you get, or whatever it is that you love offers you. No. You love whatever you love for what you offer, for the opportunity it gives you. And she says, the motherly love is of that type. And that type of love is selfless and quite noble. However, we do not live in a perfect world. That type of love is not authentic enough, or rather, it is not solid enough. Because sooner or later, you're going to run out of love if you don't get back some love. And you're taking a big chance to give your heart out to someone that doesn't feel the same way about you. So she says, in order for people to experience the ultimate unconditional love in their lives, in order for them to be happy and satisfied, in order for them to get a taste of success in life, and this is what she's saying, and this is a Western author, psychiatrist, she says they must go to the fourth level of love, and that is the love of God. The love of God. And I said, subhanAllah. The love of God. And loving everything for the sake of that love. I say this and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you and I of those who love Him. And love none like they love Him. اللهم إني أسألك حبك وحب من يحبك وحب عملي يقربني إلى حبك أقول هذا القول وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه يغفر لكم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أيها الإخوة، إن المحبة كما ذكر أهل العلم هي المنزلة التي تنافس فيها المتنافسون، وإليها نظر العاملون، وإلى علمها شمر السابقون، وعليها تثانى المحبون، وبروح نسيمها تروح العابدون، فهي قوت القلوب وغذاء الروح، وهي الحياة التي من حرمها فهو من جملة الأموات. والنور الذي من فقده فهو تائه في بحر الظلمات، والشفاء الذي من علمه حلت بقلبه جميع الأسقام، واللذة التي من لم يظفر بها فعيشه كله هموم وآلام. أيها الإخوة، أيها الأحبة، إن المحبة هي التي ذهب أهلها بشرف الدنيا والآخرة، إذ لهم في معية محبوبهم أوفر نصيب. تعلقت قلوبهم بالله وأحبوا الله عز وجل فأحبهم الله، يحبهم ويحبونه. واعلموا أن الله إذا أحب عبدا، يقول الله عز وجل: وما زال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه، فإذا أحببته كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به، وبصره التي يبصر بها، ويده التي يبطش بها، ورجله التي يمشي بها، ولئن سألني لأعطينه، ولئن استعاذني لأعيذنه. أيها الإخوة، من كان محتارا في شأن نفسه وفيما إليه وفيما آل إليه حاله، من كان يتساءل: لماذا لا أحس بطعم الإيمان؟ لماذا لا أخشع في صلاتي؟ لعل المحبة عندك ضعيفة، لعل المحبة عندك لله عز وجل ليس كما ينبغي. لأن الله عز وجل يذكر من حال المؤمنين بأن في سورة البقرة في الآية في آية 165 يقول الله عز وجل: والذين آمنوا أشد حبا لله. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: ثلاثة من كن فيه وجد فيهن حلاوة الإيمان. ولا يمكن الإنسان أن يهنأ بعيشه إذا لم يجد حلاوة الإيمان، إذا لم يستمتع في صلاته ويخشع فيها، وإذا لم يستجلب عظمة الله عز وجل ومحبته في صدقته وفي صيامه وزكاته وصومه وحجه، لن يهنأ الإنسان بعيشه. إذا لم تطمئن قلبه إلى ما ابتلاه الله عز وجل به، وإذا لم يشكر الله عز وجل على نعمه ويلاحظ نعم الله عز وجل عليه، فإن الإنسان سيعيش في تعاسة وفي هم وفي كمل. لذلك قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: ثلاثة من كن فيه وجد بهن حلاوة الإيمان. تريد حلاوة الإيمان؟ تريد أن تستلذ في الدنيا والعيش فيها؟ إليك الخصال التي ذكرها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما، أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما، وأن يحب المرء لا يحبه إلا لله، وأن يكره أن يعود في الكفر كما بعد إذ أنقذه الله منه كما يكره أن يؤخذ في النار. طيب، كيف نستجلب محبة الله عز وجل؟ لأنه سؤال صعب. إني إذا سألت أو إنك إذا سألت أحد، أي أحد من الناس، هل يحب الله عز وجل؟ كلنا يزعم أنه يحبه. هل تحب الله عز وجل؟ هل تحب الله عز وجل حقا؟ كيف تستجلب محبة الله عز وجل؟ أيها الأخوة، إنما الأحب الله عز وجل لا بد له أن يقرأ كلام الله، لأنه من أحب الله أحب كلام الله. من سره أن يحب الله ورسوله فليقرأ القرآن. فأول عوامل محبة الله عز وجل أو تقوية محبة الله عز وجل في القلوب هو قراءة كتاب الله عز وجل بتدبر. ثانيا، التقرب إلى الله عز وجل بالنوافل، كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: وما زال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه. تقرب إلى الله عز وجل بالنوافل بعد أداء الفرائض. ثالثا، مداومة ذكر الله عز وجل، لأن الإنسان إذا أحب شيئا ذكره أكثر من ذكره، ومن أحب الله عز وجل فلا بد من أن يكثر من ذكره. العجيب في الذكر أن الذكر له أثر على القلب. تذكر الله عز وجل فيذكرك الله عز وجل، تذكر الله ف فيذكرك الله عز وجل فيحدث ذلك في قلبك طمأنينة. يقول الله عز وجل الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب. رابعا أن تؤثر محاب الله على محاب نفسك، يعني ما يحبه الله عز وجل يقدم على ما تحبه نفسك. فإن حدث تعارض بين ما تحبه أنت وما يحبه الله عز وجل تضحي بما تحبه وتقدم محبة ما يحبه الله عز وجل. خامسا التدبر والتفكر في آلاء الله ونعمه وفي أسمائه وصفاته. سادسا مشاهدة بره وإحسانه وتفضله عليك وما بكم من نعمة فمن الله. سابعا الخلوة بالله عز وجل خاصة في أوقات التجليات كوقت قيام الليل، فإن هذا مما يستوجب محبة الله عز وجل لعبده. ثامنا مجالسة المؤمنين الصالحين المحبين لله عز وجل الذين يكون حديثهم أو أكثره أو جله عن الله عز وجل. إذا جلس مع إنسان كل ما يتحدث عن شيء يذكر الله عز وجل ويكثر من ذكر الله عز وجل وقلبه متعلق بالله، هذا الإنسان سيعينك على تقوية هذه المحبة في قلبك. تاسعا البعد عن كل سبب يحول بين القلب وبين الله عز وجل. هذه أسباب التسعة من طلبها فإني أرجو الله عز وجل أن يجد في قلبه محبة له. ومن أحب الله أحب الله، ومن أحب الله أحب لقاء الله، ومن أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه. أسأل الله عز وجل أن يجعلني وإياكم من المحبين. Dear brothers and sisters, now that we know that everything revolves around what the person has passion for, what the person loves, and we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had love and passion for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his concern was to earn the love of Allah azza wa jalla. And as I was talking to this brother, he said, look, if you love Allah azza wa jalla, for instance, right, you will rush to the remembrance of Allah or you will rush to the prayer. Right? And it depends. You see, the person's commitment to Salah, for example, is an indication of that person's love for Allah. So someone who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once a week, they will pray once a week. And someone who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day in and day out, they're going to pray day in and day out. And he says that because of that love, they're going to show commitment to Salah. And because of their commitment to Salah, they're going to schedule everything around Salah, and that will bring order and organization to their life. And I said, that's interesting, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam indeed said that his love and passion is for Allah. And he said, وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. My passion, my ultimate passion and joy was in Salah. Why? Because Salah brought him closer and put him right in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the most beloved to him. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those of our scholars and those of our righteous predecessors did not have to struggle as much as we struggle with enjoying Salah, because they had passion for Salah. And they were able to taste, they were able to get that sweet taste of Salah. Why? They had love for Allah Azza wa Jalla. So whatever brought them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and made them stand in front of Him deserved their full focus and devotion. The Prophet in the hadith actually tells us that there are three qualities. Whosoever has those three qualities, he will be able to get the sweetness of faith. He will be able to get that sweet taste of iman. He or she will have it. And the first one that he mentioned was to love Allah Azza wa Jalla and his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than they love anything or anyone else. To love Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than they love anyone else. And that is the true state of the heart of the believers. Because according to verse 165 of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّ لِلَّهِ, the believers love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. So what can we do, brothers and sisters, to love Allah Azza wa Jalla more? Well, the scholars mentioned several things. First of all, if you love Allah Azza wa Jalla, then you will love His words, the Qur'an. And you will read it. And the Qur'an will make you love Allah Azza wa Jalla. The Qur'an is our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through doing voluntary deeds. When you love Allah, you can't get enough of those things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, so you do it. That is once you have fulfilled your obligations, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not love anything more than you fulfilling your obligations, and then excelling in doing your best in voluntary deeds. Number three, to mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remember Him constantly. Always. And the beauty of this remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that it brings peace and tranquility to your heart, because when you remember Allah, Allah remembers you. When you mention Allah, Allah mentions you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the believers, their hearts find serenity and peace in the remembrance of Allah. Number four, to put whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ahead of anything else. So whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, you put it ahead of anything else. And if there's at any point any conflict between what you have passion for or what you desire, and that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love is a priority, and that comes first. And you will have no problem putting aside anything else. Number five, contemplate and ponder upon the names, the beautiful names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has awesome qualities and attributes that will help you fall in love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number six, remind yourself and consider the bounties of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Do you have anything in your life that didn't come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do you have anything in your life or any success in your life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not deserve credit for? Is there anything that you have done on your own or that you can do on your own? Any accomplishment, any achievement in your life? Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not given you enough? Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not given you everything that you need and everything that you have asked for? Number seven, spend some time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the night. Get up, pray, supplicate. If you wonder why in the month of Ramadan we get closer and we feel closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and our love for Allah increases, it is because we spend more time in ibadah. We come here during the night and we pray. That will definitely bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by the way, people spend their night doing whatever they have passion for the most. Whatever people are passionate about, that's what they dedicate their nights for. So what are your nights in this life? What are they dedicated for? The following point is, be in the company of people who love Allah, righteous people, people who talk about Allah, people who love Allah. And finally, stay away from anything that will get you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, any distraction in life that may turn you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not worth it. Brothers and sisters, our hearts and our love are precious. Love, your heart is very precious. Your heart is very precious, and no one deserves it but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So trust no one with your heart or your emotions but Allah the Almighty. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you and I of those who love Him sincerely and who are loved by Him. Those who love what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, and those who pursue that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the most. Brothers and sisters, one of those things that will happen, we are all going to face death one day. Right. And death, as scary as it is to many of us, you can think about it as something that will get you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah says, what will happen if you die? You'll just be returned to Allah. 2 days ago, we buried a 15-year-old in the cemetery. But one thing I noticed is that the cemetery is getting filled up. And tomorrow, inshallah, there is a fundraising. The MCC, the organization in charge of the cemetery, is about to buy a piece of land next to the current cemetery, which will have 2,000 spaces. they have to deposit, by the end of this month, they have to deposit $500,000. Tomorrow they have fundraising, and I learned that the tickets are sold out. You might go to the office, they might have some spaces here, but alhamdulillah, the tickets are sold out. Nonetheless, right, there are many people who cannot afford to pay for their own graves. And now it is, the cost is $2,500. Several years ago it used to be much less than that. In the future it will be much more than that. Right? So what I say is, let us all take part of this. Let us all take part of this and go ahead. This is a good investment. You're not, if you don't use it, someone else is going to use it. So please make sure that you participate in this effort, and let us make sure that we do not lose this opportunity of this piece of land. One of those things, by the way, let me just tell you, coming from other communities and dealing with people who come from other communities, one of those things that people from other communities are jealous of is the cemetery that we have here. The organization. And those of you who have not been lately to the cemetery, go and check it out. So alhamdulillah, we are blessed that we have dedicated people. We need to extend our hands, help them, and not just sit or stand and watch them. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. لأن الإنسان يجد بما تعلق قلبه به أثرا في حياته. من كانت همته في السيارة تعلق قلبه بالسيارة أصبح عنده إيش؟ هوس بموضوع السيارة. وأصبحت حياته كلها مسفرة في متابعة آخر الموديلات وما شابه. وكذلك الحال في من تعلق قلبه بأي شيء آخر. صرف حياته وجهده في سبيل ما تعلق قلبه. My dear brothers and sisters, these are the days where people talk about love and passion. Obviously. In fact, a day was dedicated for love. And many people were amongst those who celebrated yesterday as a day dedicated for this issue. As to the ruling, the Islamic ruling on celebrating or observing a day like Valentine's Day, that will inshallah be clarified at the end of the khutbah. But the occasion reminds us of the issue of love. And as they say, if you want to, and by the way, just let me just get this piece of information out of the way. Valentine's Day is also the day where most breakups take place. Most people and most relationships, or the highest number of breakups in relationships takes place on that day. I guess people come to the realization of how trivial or how shallow those relationships are, and on that day they cannot make any more commitments, so they decide to end it on that day. But putting this aside, if you want to know someone's significance in life, then you have to examine or look closely at what his concern is all about. So one's passion, concern, or love determines his or her status or significance in life. Because what we love determines how we view life. What we love, you love, determines how you live your life. You live by what you love. Whatever passion you have, that's what becomes the driving force in your life. So people who are into wealth, for example, that is a driving force in their life, and their passion becomes that wealth, and everything that they do in life will be for that purpose. And likewise, people who have passion for knowledge, or people who have passion for anything else. For instance, people who have passion for cars, they become obsessed with them. They know everything about them. People who are obsessed or have passion for sports, they become obsessed with the sports, they know everything about sports. Now, as Muslims, my dear brothers and sisters, dear believers, as Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us an example. And He ordered us to follow that example. And it was indeed the best of examples. And we all love or claim to love that example. We are all actually longing and looking forward to the day where we are going to be reunited, or where we are going to be in the company of that example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us. Each and every single one of us claims that he loves that example. Each and every single one of us dreams of the day he's going to be united with that example. And that is none other than our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what was the passion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What earned him this high status, in fact the highest status that any human being can reach? What makes millions of people love him, and what makes billions of people respect him, is the way he lived his life. And we said that the person lives his life according to whatever passion he has. So what was the passion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They say that in order for you to know what someone is passionate about, you need to look into what they pray for, what they ask for. What is it that they pray for? What is it that they ask for? What is their request in life? A quick glance at one of the supplications and prayers of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam answers this question. The Prophet, peace be upon him, it was reported that he basically was told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to ask, O Muhammad, pray, ask of me. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a long hadith, prayed. What was the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Let's just take, for the sake of time, take the last portion of that prayer. He says in his prayer, he said, O Allah, I ask for your love. And the love of those who love you, or those who have your love. And the love of any deed or any action that will get me closer to your love. This was the passion of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yesterday, brothers and sisters, I was having a conversation with a brother when he said something very profound. I found it to be very interesting. He said love. And we weren't actually, subhanAllah, talking about even this issue. We were talking about time management, how one could organize his life and all of that. So he said, love actually helps organize or bring order to your life. And I said, how come? He said, look for example at a single person or someone who falls in love with something or someone. All of a sudden, their life, their activities, everything starts revolving around that love and that passion of theirs. People get married. They have a chaotic lifestyle, they get married, all of a sudden they become organized. Everything works around that love of theirs. So I said, yeah, that's quite an observation. So he said, in order to bring some kind of order or organization in anyone's life, they have to have some kind of love, something that they have, they are in love with. But that love has to be solid. And that's what many people who think they have love in their lives, or who are looking for love, that's what many people miss. A solid, authentic love. That's what causes psychiatrist to write an article. And in the article she said that love is of four levels. And most people don't realize this. She said the first level is the love of something for what it offers you, what it grants you, what it gives you, what you get out of it. And then she gives an example. You know, you might love a child, for example, right? For that pleasure or that you get from looking at them. They're very cute, they're very nice. Or you might like some kind of food for its taste, for whatever you get out of it. And she said, this kind of love is a very shallow love, very trivial, very selfish. The second level of love is to love something or to love someone for what they love about you, for what they like about you. So for instance, someone thinks that you're funny, or someone thinks that you are good, or someone thinks that you are ethical, or someone thinks that you're cute, or someone thinks whatever they think of you. And because they have good feelings about you or for you, then you start exchanging those kind of feelings with them. So this is a mutual type of love. However, she says, it's not much better than the previous one, the first one, because it is also a selfish, a shallow love. For in reality, the person is in love with nothing other than themselves, because you love what the other person loves about you. That takes us to the third level of love, which is the love of what you offer, not what you get or whatever it is that you love offers you. No, you love whatever you love for what you offer, for the opportunity it gives you. And she says the motherly love is of that type, and that type of love is selfless and quite noble. However, we do not live in a perfect world. That type of love is not authentic enough, or rather, it is not solid enough, because sooner or later you're going to run out of love if you don't get back some love. And you're taking a big chance to give your heart out to someone that doesn't feel the same way about you. So she says, in order for people to experience the ultimate unconditional love in their lives, in order for them to be happy and satisfied, in order for them to get a taste of success in life, and this is what she's saying, and this is a Western author, psychiatrist, she says they must go to the fourth level of love, and that is the love of God. The love of God. And I said, subhanAllah, the love of God, and loving everything for the sake of that love. I say this and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you and I of those who love Him, and love none like they love Him. Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbak wa hubba man yuhibbuk wa hubba amali yuqarribuni ila hubbik. Aqulu hadha alqawla astaghfirullah li wa lakum fastaghfiruhu yaghfir lakum. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أيها الإخوة، إن المحبة كما ذكر أهل العلم هي المنزلة التي تنافس فيها المتنافسون، وإليها نظر العاملون، وإلى علمها شمر السابقون، وعليها تثانى المحبون، وبروح نسيمها تروح العابدون، فهي قوت القلوب وغذاء الروح، وهي الحياة التي من حرمها فهو من جملة الأموات، والنور الذي من فقده فهو تائه في بحر الظلمات، والشفاء الذي من علمه حلت بقلبه جميع الأسقام، واللذة التي من لم يظفر بها فعيشه كله هموم وآلام. أيها الإخوة، أيها الأحبة، إن المحبة هي التي ذهب أهلها بشرف الدنيا والآخرة، إذ لهم في معية محبوبهم أوفر نصيب، تعلقت قلوبهم بالله وأحبوا الله عز وجل فأحبهم الله، يحبهم ويحبونه. واعلموا أن الله إذا أحب عبدا، يقول الله عز وجل: وما زال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه، فإذا أحببته كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به، وبصره التي يبصر بها، ويده التي يبطش بها، ورجله التي يمشي بها، ولئن سألني لأعطينه، ولئن استعاذني لأعيذنه. أيها الإخوة، من كان محتارا في شأن نفسه وفيما إليه وفيما آل إليه حاله، من كان يتساءل: لماذا لا أحس بطعم الإيمان؟ لماذا لا أخشع في صلاتي؟ لعل المحبة عندك ضعيفة، لعل المحبة عندك لله عز وجل ليس كما ينبغي. لأن الله عز وجل يذكر من حال المؤمنين بأن في سورة البقرة في الآية في آية 165 يقول الله عز وجل: والذين آمنوا أشد حبا لله. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: ثلاثة من كنا فيه وجد بهن حلاوة الإيمان. ولا يمكن للإنسان أن يهنأ بعيشه إذا لم يجد حلاوة الإيمان، إذا لم يستمتع في صلاته ويخشع فيها، وإذا لم يستجلب عظمة الله عز وجل ومحبته في صدقته وفي صيامه وزكاته وصومه وحجه، لن يهنأ الإنسان بعيشه. إذا لم تطمئن قلبه إلى ما ابتلاه الله عز وجل به، وإذا لم يشكر الله عز وجل على نعمه ويلاحظ نعم الله عز وجل عليه، فإن الإنسان سيعيش في تعاسة وفي هم وفي كمل. لذلك قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: ثلاثة من كن فيه وجد بهن حلاوة الإيمان. تريد حلاوة الإيمان؟ تريد أن تستلذ بالدنيا والعيش فيها؟ إليك الخصال التي ذكرها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما، أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما، وأن يحب المرء لا يحبه إلا لله، وأن يكره أن يعود في الكفر كما بعد إذ أنقذه الله منه كما يكره أن يخلد في النار. طيب، كيف نستجلب محبة الله عز وجل؟ لأنه سؤال صعب. إني إذا سألت أو إنك إذا سألت أحد، أي أحد من الناس، هل يحب الله عز وجل؟ كلنا يفرض أنه يحبه. هل تحب الله عز وجل؟ هل تحب الله عز وجل حقا؟ كيف تستجلب محبة الله عز وجل؟ أيها الإخوة، إنما أحب الله عز وجل لا بد له أن يقرأ كلام الله، لأنه من أحب الله أحب كلام الله. من سره أن يحب الله ورسوله فليقرأ القرآن. فأول عوامل محبة الله عز وجل أو تقوية محبة الله عز وجل في القلوب هو قراءة كتاب الله عز وجل بتدبر. ثانيا، التقرب إلى الله عز وجل بالنوافل، كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: ما زال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه. تقرب إلى الله عز وجل بالنوافل بعد أداء الفرائض. ثالثا، مداومة ذكر الله عز وجل، لأن الإنسان إذا أحب شيئا ذكره أكثر من ذكره، ومن أحب الله عز وجل فلا بد من أن يكثر من ذكره. العجيب في الذكر أن الذكر له أثر على القلب. تذكر الله عز وجل فيذكرك الله عز وجل، تذكر الله فيذكرك الله عز وجل، فيحدث ذلك في قلبك طمأنينة. يقول الله عز وجل: الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله، ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب. رابعا، أن تؤثر محاب الله على محاب نفسك، يعني ما يحبه الله عز وجل يقدم على ما تحبه نفسك. فإن حدث تعارض بين ما تحبه أنت وما يحبه الله عز وجل، تضحي بما تحبه وتقدم محبة ما يحبه الله عز وجل. خامسا، التدبر والتفكر في آلاء الله ونعمه وفي أسمائه وصفاته. سادسا مشاهدة بره وإحسانه وتفضله عليك وما بكم من نعمة فمن الله. سابعا الخلوة بالله عز وجل خاصة في أوقات التجليات كوقت قيام الليل، فإن هذا مما يستوجب محبة الله عز وجل لعبده. ثامنا مجالسة المؤمنين الصالحين المحبين لله عز وجل الذين يكون حديثهم أو أكثره أو جله عن الله عز وجل. إذا جلس مع الإنسان كل ما يتحدث عن شيء يذكر الله عز وجل ويكثر من ذكر الله عز وجل وقلبه متعلق بالله، هذا الإنسان سيعينك على تقوية هذه المحبة في قلبك. تاسعا البعد عن كل سبب يحول بين القلب وبين الله عز وجل. هذه أسباب تسعة، من طلبها فإني أرجو الله عز وجل أن يجد في قلبه محبة له. ومن أحب الله أحب الله، ومن أحب الله أحب لقاء الله، ومن أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه. أسأل الله عز وجل أن يجعلني وإياكم من المحبين. Dear brothers and sisters, now that we know that everything revolves around what the person has passion for, what the person loves, and we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had love and passion for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his concern was to earn the love of Allah azza wa jalla. And as I was talking to this brother, he said, look, if you love Allah azza wa jalla, for instance, right, you will rush to the remembrance of Allah, or you will rush to the prayer, right? And it depends. You see, the person's commitment to Salah, for example, is an indication of that person's love for Allah. So someone who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once a week, they will pray once a week. And someone who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day in and day out, they're going to pray day in and day out. And he says that because of that love, they're going to show commitment to Salah. And because of their commitment to Salah, they're going to schedule everything around Salah, and that will bring order and organization to their life. And I said, that's interesting, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam indeed said that his love and passion is for Allah. And he said, وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. My passion, my ultimate passion and joy was in Salah. Why? Because Salah brought him closer and put him right in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the most beloved to him. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those of our scholars and those of our righteous predecessors did not have to struggle as much as we struggle with enjoying Salah, because they had passion for Salah. And they were able to taste, they were able to get that sweet taste of Salah. Why? They had love for Allah Azza wa Jalla. So whatever brought them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and made them stand in front of Him deserved their full focus and devotion. The Prophet in the hadith actually tells us that there are three qualities. Whosoever has those three qualities, he will be able to get the sweetness of faith. He will be able to get that sweet taste of iman. He or she will have it. And the first one that he mentioned was to love Allah Azza wa Jalla and his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than they love anything or anyone else. To love Allah and his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than they love anyone else. And that is the true state of the heart of the believers. Because according to verse 165 of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّ لِلَّهِ, the believers love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. So what can we do, brothers and sisters, to love Allah azza wa jalla more? Well, the scholars mention several things. First of all, if you love Allah azza wa jalla, then you will love His words, the Qur'an. And you will read it. And the Qur'an will make you love Allah azza wa jalla. The Qur'an is our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through doing voluntary deeds. When you love Allah, you can't get enough of those things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, so you do it. That is, once you have fulfilled your obligations, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not love anything more than you fulfilling your obligations and then excelling and doing your best in voluntary deeds. Number three, to mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remember Him constantly. Always. And the beauty of this remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that it brings peace and tranquility to your heart, because when you remember Allah, Allah remembers you. When you mention Allah, Allah mentions you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the believers, their hearts find serenity and peace in the remembrance of Allah. Number four, to put whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ahead of anything else. So whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, you put it ahead of anything else. And if there's at any point any conflict between what you have passion for or what you desire and that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love is a priority and that comes first. And you will have no problem putting aside anything else. Number five, contemplate and ponder upon the names, the beautiful names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has awesome qualities and attributes that will help you fall in love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number six, remind yourself and consider the bounties of Allah azza wa jalla. Do you have anything in your life that didn't come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do you have anything in your life or any success in your life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not deserve credit for? Is there anything that you have done on your own or that you can do on your own? Any accomplishment, any achievement in your life? Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not given you enough? Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not given you everything that you need and everything that you have asked for? Number seven, spend some time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the night. Get up, pray, supplicate. If you wonder why in the month of Ramadan we get closer and we feel closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and our love for Allah increases, it is because we spend more time in ibadah. We come here during the night and we pray. That will definitely bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by the way, people spend their night doing whatever they have passion for the most. Whatever people are passionate about, that's what they dedicate their nights for. So what are your nights in this life? What are they dedicated for? The following point is, be in the company of people who love Allah, righteous people who talk about Allah, people who love Allah. And finally, stay away from anything that will get you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, any distraction in life that may turn you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not worth it. Brothers and sisters, our hearts and our love are precious. Love. Your heart is very precious. Your heart is very precious and no one deserves it but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So trust no one with your heart or your emotions but Allah the Almighty. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you and I of those who love Him sincerely and who are loved by Him. Those who love what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves and those who pursue that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the most. Brothers and sisters, one of those things that will happen, we are all going to face death one day. Right. And death, as scary as it is to many of us, you can think about it as something that will get you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah says, when I went to Allah, what will happen if you die? You'll just be returned to Allah. 2 days ago, we buried a 15-year-old in the cemetery. But one thing I noticed is that the cemetery is getting filled up. And tomorrow, inshallah, there is a fundraising. The MCC, the organization in charge of the cemetery, is about to buy a piece of land next to the current cemetery, which will have 2,000 spaces. They have to deposit, by the end of this month, they have to deposit $500,000. Tomorrow they have fundraising, and I learned that the tickets are sold out. You might go to the office, they might have some spaces here, but alhamdulillah, the tickets are sold out. Nonetheless, right, there are many people who cannot afford to pay for their own graves. And now it is, the cost is $2,500. Several years ago it used to be much less than that. In the future it will be much more than that. Right? So what I say is, let us all take part of this. Let us all take part of this and go ahead. This is a good investment. You're not, if you don't use it, someone else is going to use it. So please make sure that you participate in this effort, and let us make sure that we do not lose this opportunity of this piece of land. One of those things, by the way, let me just tell you, coming from other communities and dealing with people who come from other communities, one of those things that people from other communities are jealous of is the cemetery that we have here. The organization. And those of you who have not been lately to the cemetery, go and check it out. So alhamdulillah, we are blessed that we have dedicated people. We need to extend our hands, help them, and not just sit or stand and watch them. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.